Okay, so today we'll continue with observed properties of pulsars a bit more. We'll see what other aspects give us clues on what is going on in pulsar magnetism. I have to mention at this point that pulsars have been studied, particularly at radio wavelengths, for a very long time now, and with great sensitivity and timing resolution. So there are humongous number of phenomenological characteristics which have been documented. And the theoretical understanding of pulsars is nowhere near uncovering all the details that the observations reveal. So I will not be getting into elaborate description of the complete phenomenology of observations that people have uncovered over time. I will only pick up a few issues which give us some clues about the gross properties of the magnetosphere. And later on, as we go along in the course, we'll try to see how these gross properties can be attempted to be explained by existing models. Now, this is something we discussed yesterday, and this shows you the broadband spectrum of the Crab pulsar, and this gives us an indication that the radio emission, which is shown here, and the high energy emission, they seem to be some produced by some distinct processes. And there will be other further evidence which will bolster that conclusion. One thing also to note is that the total amount of energy that is emitted at radio bands for all these pulsars is usually a small fraction of the net radiative energy lost by the pulsar. The vertical axis here is nu f nu, so it is like the amount of total energy emitted in that band. And you can see that that peaks around hard X-rays to gamma rays. So, 10 keV to 1 MeV region is where the maximum emission is for the Crab pulsar. We will take a look at what fraction of the total energy that is being tapped from the pulsar goes into radiation in a little while. But before that, we'll also recall that pulsar emission is strongly polarized, and both in radio and now when it is seen at high energies and polarization can be measured, we see that a very high degree of polarization, which is not normally seen in most other astronomical sources. There are pulsars which, for part of their emission cycle, in radio could be almost 100% linearly polarized. So it's a very strongly polarized radiation that we see at all bands from pulsars. The fact that this is strongly polarized, what does that tell us about radiation mechanism? So, can someone guess as to if you have polarization? In this case, for example, let's take this Crab pulsar. So, degree of polarization can reach about 70-80% over here, right? And it's strongly polarized all through. 40% here, nearly 80% there. This is in radio. And this is the angle of polarization, which makes a gradual smooth curve in case of Crab pulsar and many other pulsars in radio band. We have already seen that in high energy band, polarization fraction is still again around 30-40%, but the position angle is practically constant. It changes a little bit through the entire pulse period. So that also is an indicator that these two emission mechanisms are not directly related. So what does polarization tell us about the emission mechanism? Or about the conditions that lead to this emission?
There are preferred directions.
Go ahead.
So polarization actually tells you that there is a selective direction. So for a pulsar, consider the magnetic field. So that would impart a direction. So magnetic field is an important component in understanding
okay.
the emission.
Fair enough. What it tells us is that there is a very strong inherent anisotropy in the process.
The motion of the charged body is highly constrained, what we can say, right? In particular,
the
velocity is in one direction.
Okay, so let's look at the instantaneous electric vector. So, electric vector. Radiated by a particle is let's call it radiation part of the electric vector is proportional to, I'm dropping the constants in front, okay. Given instant, the particle executes a motion with a certain velocity and a certain acceleration. Acceleration is required for any radiation field to exist. If acceleration is zero, there is no radiation. So now, at a given instant of time, all these directions are defined. There is a certain direction of motion. There is a certain direction of acceleration. And n is the line joining the particle to the observer, unit vector, in the along the line of sight. So instantaneous radiation from a single particle always has a very well-defined direction of electric field. So that is what you would call a 100% polarization. And this is intrinsic of the electromagnetic radiation process itself. But what happens when we actually see radiation from a macroscopic source? This is for a single charged particle at one instant of time. So we have averaging taking place both over time and over multiple particles. So, in the source, which is not made up of just one particle moving, you have a given particle, which when we observe a bit of radiation, you're already averaging over a little bit of time. We never observe something which is at any instant. We integrate over whatever integration time our instrument is giving us. So it could be millisecond, it could be microsecond, but there is still an average over that time. And averaged over that time, both beta and beta dot can vary. So the averaged value of beta and beta dot could be not the same as the value at any given instant. So as beta and beta dot change, the direction of the electric field that you will get will also change. And therefore, you will get a smearing over the over time, and that will give you a loss of polarization. One example, for example, you can take is, let's say a charged particle moving in a magnetic field. It undergoes periodic motion. even if we ignore motion along the magnetic field, over time it will execute a circular motion. So the electric field will undergo circular excursion. So depending on where you are looking at it, you will actually see a circular polarization in that case. If you are looking at it in the plane of the orbit, then you will see that the charged particle is executing a back and forth harmonic motion. So you will see linear polarization. So what you see from the charged particle comes from the time averaged motion of the particle. Now there is not one particle in the system. But the system will have many, many particles, each with their own velocity and their own acceleration. So if you leave a system with isotropically distributed velocities and no specific agent that gives you an average direction of acceleration, which is macroscopically averaged, you still have a net directionality in acceleration. In that case, you will get totally unpolarized radiation. Let's take radiation from a hot thermal body. And let us say the body is optically thin, so we are not talking about multiple scatterings or absorption radiation. So one example of the process that will lead to radiation from such a body is Bremsstrahlung. So the Bremsstrahlung is also caused by acceleration and velocity. So particle moving, let's say electron moving around an ion, will be accelerated and it will produce radiation. But since the ions are also isotropically distributed, all velocities are isotropically distributed in a thermal system, there is no net average direction of acceleration. There is no average net average direction of velocity. And as a result, this will produce unpolarized radiation. So to produce strong polarization, you need some anisotropy in the process. It is often stated that processes like Thomson scattering or Compton scattering can produce polarization. Now, that statement needs to be qualified. In the same situation which I mentioned, if you have an isotropic radiation field and you put this isotropic distribution of particles in this radiation field, then each of these particles will scatter from the radiation field and you will get scattered radiation. But then again, there is actually no net directionality, and even with Compton scattering or Thomson scattering, you will not generate any polarization. In reality, what you see, for example, the sun's radiation near the edges of the sun are polarized because of Thomson scattering. And the Thomson scattering process itself is anisotropic. You get a distribution of radiation, scattered radiation, which is which depends on the direction of scattering. And they carry different directions of electric field. Now, towards the edge of the sun, you get a net polarization because the radiation field is not isotropic. There is a net outward flow of radiation. So if you go to any one point near the sun's limb, you will have a larger amount of radiation producing moving radially forward than in other directions. And that's because there is a net radiative flux out of the sun. And it is that which imposes polarization of the radiation. Same is true if Compton scattering has to produce polarization from bulk motion of fluid. So you have an isotropic radiation field, let's say in a cosmic microwave background, but if you have a bulk motion of charged plasma, then the direction of velocity of this bulk motion imposes the anisotropic, and the scattered radiation can be polarized. So you need some kind of anisotropic. And in case of pulsars, as you correctly mentioned, the anisotropy mainly comes from the magnetic field. Magnetic field then also imposes anisotropy in the velocity field of particles, which generate this radiation.
Excuse me.
Yes.
But the presence of the magnetic field doesn't automatically come from the polarization, right?
No. Just the polarization alone is not going to tell you that this is coming due to magnetic field. You need to add additional information, like spectra and other information as well. So now let us remember that in radio you have a polarization angle sweep of this kind. And this is actually quite common among pulsars in radio emission. This is not seen clearly in high energy emission. You do see polarization angle changes in the crab, but not of a systematic pattern of this kind. And certainly not of this large amplitude. So, now, let's see what interpretation people have made of this. Now, the systematic variation of polarization, this was one of the very first objects for which this was studied. This was Vela pulsar in 1969 by Radhakrishnan and Cook. So, this is the pulse profile. And these are the polarization vectors, observed polarization vectors, drawn within the pulse profile as the pulse passes by you. So as you can see, there is a very systematic change in direction. And if you plot this as a position angle as a function of time, you will get a curve like this, and that's known as the S-curve. So right from this time, from this paper itself, this behavior has been attributed to the intrinsic radio emission mechanism, which has been conjectured to be curvature radiation in this case. How many of you are familiar with curvature radiation? Okay, so it's not much. No. How many of you are familiar with synchrotron radiation? Right. So, what happens in a synchrotron radiation? You have a magnetic field and you have a particle gyrating in the magnetic field. So, you execute a curved path, and that curved path happens because of an acceleration. That acceleration causes the particle to radiate, and you get a radiation. Now, if you look at the motion of particles in a magnetic field, particularly strong magnetic field, then you have classically this gyrating motion around the magnetic field. But you can also describe this process quantum mechanically. And then you will find that this gyrating motion is actually quantized in energy levels. These are called Landau levels. And the spacing between the Landau levels will give you the cyclotron emission frequency. the lowest Landau level has zero perpendicular momentum around the magnetic field, which means the as you gyrate around this magnetic field, you will produce radiation. As you produce radiation, you come down the Landau levels, from higher Landau level to lower, and so on. Ultimately, you will reach the lowest Landau level, where there is actually no gyrating motion. The entire momentum of the electron is now parallel to the magnetic field. So the only motion left is to just go along the magnetic field. Everything, all the energy that was there in motion perpendicular to the field has been radiated away in synchrotron process. Now that it is in this state, unless enough energy is provided externally for it to be excited to the next Landau level, as the magnetic field proceeds in a certain direction, the particle will actually keep going in that direction. Even if the magnetic field is a little curved, it will have to follow the curve that the magnetic field, along the magnetic field, you have energy still available. So you can have a motion along the magnetic field. The magnetic field may be curving. The particle may want to retain its inertial motion and then deviate away from the field. But until that component of the perpendicular momentum becomes sufficient to raise it to the next Landau level, it cannot do so. It will have to keep following the magnetic field like a bead on a string. And this motion, if the magnetic field is curved, is going to cause an acceleration to the particle because the magnetic field is not straight, it is now moving in a curve. And this is what is called curvature radiation. And radio emission from pulsars have been attributed to it. And it's a very attractive mechanism because if you look at, so the properties will be quite similar to synchrotron radiation. You just replace the radius of curvature of the orbit by the radius of curvature of the field line. And all other properties will be similar to synchrotron radiation. And since the radius of curvature of the field line is much, much larger than the radius of curvature of the Landau orbits, the frequency of emission is correspondingly lower. If you look at the synchrotron emission in typical magnetic field of pulsars near the surface, you will get high energy gamma ray emission. However, if you replace that radius of curvature by the radius of curvature of the dipole field line, then you get radio emission. So, therefore, this is a fairly attractive mechanism for radio emission that we see. And it does have predictions which can explain some of the observed features, including this S curve. What this tells you, if you interpret it, acceleration is centripetal acceleration along the radius of curvature. Beta is the motion along the magnetic field. And if you put this together, then you ask, if I now project this in the sky, this electric field, what will be the net projected angle in the sky of this electric field? So in case of synchrotron radiation, do you know what it is? Synchrotron radiation from a bunch of particles. And you have a, let us say, uniform homogeneous magnetic field. If you look at the projected electric field in the sky, does it have relation with the direction of the magnetic field?
Polarization is close to 70%. max.
No, that's the degree. I'm talking about the angle.
1 by gamma point.
Angle. Angle of the polarization in the plane of the sky. So this was basic property of synchrotron radiation. All astronomers must be familiar with right in the beginning. So in case of synchrotron radiation, the projected direction of the polarization in the plane of the sky is perpendicular to the projection of the magnetic field. So magnetic field can be in some direction. You project the magnetic field in the plane of the sky. So let's say it is some line like that. The synchrotron radiation originating in this magnetic field would be perpendicular to this line. Projected vector in the plane of the sky.
This is from what you were saying earlier, if where the gyration is happening and
yeah.
they're looking along the
so it's
plane of
a consequence of this. But then you have to average the fact that there are particles with different pitch angles with velocity distribution in different directions. So the net polarization is perpendicular to the magnetic field. So by that analogy, what will be the direction of polarization in this case? You have, in the other case, you have magnetic field. The acceleration is perpendicular to the magnetic field.
This should
correct?
Be along the magnetic field.
Yes. So in this case, the projected polarization will be parallel to the projected magnetic field. Okay? Because it is the radius of curvature of this magnetic field that is causing the acceleration. So that is the diagram which is drawn here. This, both these diagrams are from the original paper of Radhakrishnan Ankur. So you have, let's say you're looking down the polar cap of a dipole field, and you project the magnetic field lines in the sky. So you have these field lines, projected field lines. They are actually coming towards you, but when you project it, it will splay out like that. Now the particles are moving along these magnetic fields. And because of curvature radiation, the electric vector will now be parallel to these magnetic fields. So now you see that as the pulsar rotates, your line of sight will cut through this bunch of magnetic fields in a certain manner. So here is the trajectory of the line of sight through the pole. So at any given point of time, you are going to see radiation from this magnetic field which is pointing towards you. Now this brings me back to one more point. If there are particles which are present all over these magnetic field lines and they're all producing radiation, then sitting at any given point here, I should be able to see radiation from all of them. Do I see that or do I not see that? So there are some particles moving this way, some particles moving that way. All of them are radiating, so I should be able to see radiation from all of them. And if I do, then I will not get this polarization maybe. So it does look like that I don't see the radiation from all the magnetic field lines together. I do see radiation from only something which is directly in my line of sight. The other magnetic fields, field lines, which are away from my line of sight, pointing away from my line of sight, radiation from that is not coming to me. What does that signify? Yes?
Because of some type of beaming effect.
That is correct. So that tells you that radiation must be strongly beamed along the field lines. if the radiation has to be strongly beamed along the field lines, what mechanism do we know which can produce such a beaming?
Motion relativistic particles.
Yes. So this means that the particles which are responsible for this radiation must have very high Lorentz factor and be moving along the field lines. So from this we conclude the following thing, that the particles have high Lorentz factor, so you don't mix radiation from neighboring field lines, and the particles are in the lowest Landau level, so that they go along the field line and produce curvature radiation. And once they do so, now you see that you will see electric vector which is parallel to this, and the next moment you will see electric vector which is parallel to that, and then that, and then that, and then that, and that will explain this kind of behavior of polarization. This model has come to be known as the rotating vector model, which is one of the mainstay in radio pulsar astronomy in trying to understand the geometry of pulsar emission. But I put a caveat over here. This is all fine. In case of Vela, this works very nicely. Actually, in case of Crab also, it works more or less nicely. But we know of objects where we see this nice S-curve going along, then sudden switch to a 90-degree orthogonal polarization angle, and then switch back to the original polarization angle. So there appears to be two states which the radiation keeps going back and forth. This is called orthogonal modes. And here is an example. So let's take this average profile of this pulsar 2020 plus 28. So you see the polarization angle going on nicely, suddenly makes a 90-degree switch up, goes on that track, and suddenly makes a 90-degree switch down, goes down. If you look at it in more detail, this is for an average profile. You take single pulses, and then keep plotting the polarization angle for single pulses, then you see that this is actually not an exclusive phenomenon at some longitudes. There are large regions where these orthogonal modes can survive together, which means it is sometimes here, sometimes there. In some pulses, at this longitude, the polarization is here. In another pulse, at the same longitude, the polarization is over there. So it's basically a process which is continuously switching between these two modes. But they're well-defined modes. They're separated by 90 degrees. But they are not the same single polarization. So this clearly tells us that the picture is not really as simple as a very geometric curvature radiation model. This kind of orthogonal polarization switch immediately brings into mind the existence of plasma modes. In a plasma, usually when electromagnetic wave propagates in a plasma, there are two modes that you will get. One is called an ordinary mode, one is an extraordinary mode, and they're perpendicular in polarization with respect to each other. And it looks like there is propagation through a plasma, and you are exciting the orthogonal modes, sometimes the ordinary mode, and sometimes the extraordinary mode. So,
Dipankar?
Yes.
So for curvature radiation, you also know that 70% of the polarization confined to the plane of the magnetic field, and there will also be component polarization perpendicular to it. So does that play a role in understanding this phenomenon?
No, the whatever is perpendicular to the field will get averaged out between neighboring field lines. So that gets cancelled basically. Unless only one field line is populated with particles and the other field lines are not, which is of course not the case. Then you will not see radiation over other longitudes. But the fact that intrinsic radiation mechanism has this both these components can be used to excite ordinary and extraordinary mode in a plasma. So finally, what comes out depends on the propagation through the plasma, which mode is resonating at that particular time. And the plasma conditions clearly are highly variable. It is not something like a steady, homogeneous, stationary plasma that you are dealing with here. Every moment, the plasma characteristics are changing, the plasma distribution is changing. As a result, you can get sometimes ordinary mode dominating, sometimes extraordinary mode dominating. We'll see other examples of stochasticity or instability in the emission process. So, we have these two modes. Now, knowing that these modes are excited either to be parallel or to be perpendicular to the field, we can say, okay, so now we will compensate for this 90 degree flip. We will, when it moves to orthogonal mode, then we know that the corresponding ordinary mode would be somewhere else, would be 90 degrees away. So we can bring this curve down and then line it all up together and make one single S-curve. And that one single S-curve can then be used to infer the geometry of the pulsar emission.
One second.
Yes.
So if you go back, so the one in between is in the bridge region, right? And the other two is coming in the pulse, inside the pulsed emission.
Yes. And the whole thing is pulse. So,
yeah.
And see, this is not like the crab. This is the longitude, which is minus 15 degrees to plus 15 degrees.
Ah, okay.
This is a single pulse with a dip in between. Yeah. Yes.
Okay. So you said these are the data for single pulses.
These.
Yeah. And so they'll always prefer one of these modes. There will never be a combination such that you get a PA that is in between.
If there is, it's difficult to measure. Because single pulses, as I'll show later, single pulses don't fill this whole thing. A single pulse is like a shot inside this envelope. So a single pulse is a subpulse which would illuminate either here or there or there or there. I'll come to that in a moment. That average profile is different from a single pulse. So as in a single pulse, you are not really sampling this entire region. You're sampling either some part of this region. So before I go on to that aspect, just to introduce some terminology. So the amplitude, extent of these S-curves, polarization variation, can be different in different pulses. And this can be interpreted in terms of the geometry of the object, which has two basic parameters. One is the inclination of the magnetic axis with respect to rotation axis, which is called alpha. And another is the distance of the line of sight at the closest approach from the magnetic axis. That's called beta. And alpha plus beta is the angle that the line of sight makes with respect to the rotation axis. Yes.
Regarding the polarization.
Yeah.
So this switching between O mode and X mode, it looks like it's regular, and it does some, that happens at very short time scales.
Yeah.
Now let's say, assume that
regular meaning, it is not as though you can predict the next turn will go there. It is very stochastic.
Stochastic. Okay.
But the pattern that it follows,
but the time scale this happens is very, very, very short.
Yeah.
So, assuming that, for example, if you want to apply this for something like a solar function, so there you deal with timescales which are much larger.
Yes.
So, in that case, when you average over a large timescale, so can this cause a depolarization? This contrast can
You don't even have to average. If you didn't do the mode separation, in this case, the net polarization will be much lower. So, you get to high polarization only when you are able to recognize this and able to do mode separation. In many pulsars which originally were thought to be not strongly polarized, with better observation people have found that this is because modes getting mixed up. So if you do single pulse analysis, you put it in one mode or another mode, then you see that this polarization degree is very strong, it could be 70-80%, but when you average it, it could be very low. That is correct. Right, so basically the S curve will depend on this trajectory. How far away is the magnetic field with respect to the rotation axis, and how far away is your line of sight with respect to the magnetic axis. If you know these two angles, you can predict the shape of the S curve, and people use it the other way around. Take the S curve, try to fit this, and derive this geometry. So, if you have a well-determined S curve after the correction of these orthogonal modes and so on, then you can use that to determine the geometry of the pulsar. Now, here is an example of a fit to the S curve for Crab pulsar. So, these are the clusters of polarization measurement points that I showed you already in a previous slide. And here is an attempt to fit it with an S curve with a certain geometry. And this requires an alpha of 56 degrees and beta of 51 degrees. This may or may not be a unique answer, but this is a possible fit. So most people believe now that the angle between the spin axis and the rotation axis of the Crab pulsar is round about 60 degrees, which is what this fit is. And this has been now applied to many, many pulsars, and to have a whole list of alphas and betas for a large sample. If you are interested in studying the pulsar geometry, you can make use of that data. Now, here is what I was saying about single pulses. This is a pulsar 0943 plus 10. The average pulse profile looks like this. Now you take an average of 1,000 pulses now, take average of 1,000 pulses tomorrow, or take average of 1,000 pulses a year later, it will look very similar to this. So it's a very stable distribution of intensity. But if you go to single pulse level, then it looks very different. So these are all individual pulses. So only small parts of this envelope are illuminated at any given pulse. Only when you average it over many, many pulses, then you get the stable profile. Not only that, you see that there appears to be a pattern. Now these small pulses, they are called subpulses, and from one pulse to the next, there appears to be a drift in the phase at which the pulse appears. Goes like that and then reappears here and goes like that, reappears here, goes like that, wraps, goes like that and so on. Right? And there is a periodicity to it. This phenomenon is known as subpulse drift. Not in this pulsar, but in some other pulsars, you will find that you will have this kind of activity, and then for a very large number of pulses, there will be no detectable emission at all. Then suddenly it resumes again. Such intervals where there are no detectable radiation are called nulls. So these are all well known but not fully understood behavior of radio pulses. And radio being a coherent emission mechanism, it is more prone to this kind of fluctuations. But what it does tell you that the intrinsic process is very chaotic and stochastic. Only when you average over a long enough time, you begin to see something which is steady. So clearly the intrinsic short time scale process is very stochastic. But clearly also, there is a guiding envelope to everything. There is a guiding envelope that obviously must be decided by geometry or something fixed on the pulsar, for example, magnetic field distribution. And the inclination and our line of sight and so on. These are the things which are fixed. And average properties are decided by them. Instantaneous properties are decided by the weather on the pulsar, in the pulsar magnetosphere. So it can be highly sporadic. Yeah.
You said that being a coherent emission, all these phenomena are more prone.
Yeah.
What do you mean by that?
Because coherent emission requires charged particles to behave collectively in a certain way. So you don't have, you're not averaging individual intensities, right? And if there is a phase coherence which is lost between two particles, there will be a large change in intensity in case of coherent emission, but not in case of incoherent emission. So you need, the coherent emission has more constraints, and therefore slight change in those constraints can make a large change in intensity. There is another observed aspect in radio emission which is quite prominent in most observed pulsars, and that is, if you go from a higher radio frequency to lower radio frequency, the pulse profile of the same pulsar tends to widen. So here you are with two peaks separated by a certain phase difference at 4.8 gigahertz. Go to 2.4 gigahertz, this is certainly wider. 430 is even wider, 230 even wider. This is what, 50 megahertz, and this is very wide. There are any number of pulsars you can study between UT and GMRT which will display this behavior. So there are the two pulsars which are shown here, both showing similar behavior. This also widens a lot, going from 4.8 gigahertz to 26 megahertz. Now, how is this to be understood? Any guesses? Yes?
So the emission is taken from the field lines. So this can be thought about as the emission is taken at different heights. The beaming angle, sort of, that will depend on the height. So
right. So if this is emission in a cone, and let's say the cone is defined by the dipole field line coming out of the pulsar polar cap. The angular separation between the two tangents to the cone, or the opening angle, local opening angle of the cone, changes as you go away from the surface. So the cone opens up more as you go to higher altitudes. So this is often attributed to that fact. So that means higher radio frequencies have to originate lower down in the magnetosphere. Lower radio frequencies have to originate larger altitude in the magnetosphere. In that case, in a conal emission, you will see the cone opening up and the profile broadening as you go to lower and lower frequencies. Yeah.
Coming to it, so isn't there a degeneracy? So what, from this explanation, we'd say that okay, the emission is narrow band, which is coming from different heights, or you can say it is a broad band coming from the same height.
No, why would you have such an issue? Because if it is narrow band and coming from a large range of heights, then you will not see the when you go to then it will not have a signature of a specific opening angle. It will average over the entire range of opening angles, right? So it is narrow band, selected height. So band and height are mapped to each other, and that's what is called radius to frequency mapping. So higher frequency emission originating lower down in the magnetosphere, but if you want to, and at that same place, you do not get much of the lower frequency emission. To get to lower frequency emission, you have to go up in the magnetosphere, then you will get the radiation. There is a possible reason to this as well, and that is to do with the plasma frequency. The plasma frequency is proportional, is dependent on the density. Now, as the plasma is moving out from the pulsar and rising above, the density is dropping, and the plasma frequency will drop. So lower down, the plasma frequency may be high, so that lower frequencies don't propagate within that plasma frequency. So the plasma has to become transparent to the frequency that you want to observe for you to be able to see it. And that will have the same sense of behavior, that as you go up, plasma frequency will go down and lower and lower frequency emission will escape.
Okay.
It's 10:30, so maybe I will stop here today and then continue in the next. We'll take some questions.
Because of this sort of stratification, it's similar to
Why can't plasma radiation become simple? It can be done. What I'm suggesting now is just an effective description. I've not said anything about what is causing that emission change. Right? I just said that the effective mapping of the maximum of radiation of a given frequency is radius. What is the mechanism that is producing it is not something that this description actually really cares about. It's just a geometric effect that one has stated so far. And I have to say that this is actually not fully understood from first principles in terms of emission mechanism. There is still a long way to go before the details of the coherent radio emission mechanism are fully understood. We seem to understand a little better the incoherent emission mechanisms, which are mostly relevant at higher energies, which we will see as we proceed in the course. But radio emission mechanism is still much, much harder to understand.
The intensity ratios of two lines are also changing from higher frequency to...
Sorry?
The intensity ratio of two successive lines are also changing from...
No, these are the two parts of the profile. Yes. The profile shape also can change. It's not just the width, even the shape can change.
I'm saying intensity ratios, I mean that is also changing.
Yes, profile shape meaning
okay.
Intensity ratio compared to any normalized, any point of normalization, the intensity at other points. If that changes, then the profile shape changes. It changes here also.
Yeah.
So that's also fairly common in pulsars. Profiles normally are not independent of radio frequency.
Probably I can understand properly this presence of two modes within the single pulse that we plot you have shown. What conclusion? I could say that there are two modes, but happening at the same longitude. That's what I didn't really understand. What's the implication of that?
The implication is that the it's clearly not just plain curvature emission. Plain curvature emission at a given longitude, you have the same magnetic field geometry, particles moving along. You should never see this
other mode appearing.
Yeah.
So it's basically.
So it means that there is plasma propagation, which alters the view of the emission that you see. So it can excite both the mode that the fundamental mode, which is along the field line. But it can also excite the perpendicular mode, which will produce polarization perpendicular to the field. It's not an aggregation of single particle curvature emission. It's a collective mode of the plasma, which is responsible for the final emission that you see. Although the curvature emission may be the one that is exciting this. But what is coming out from the magnetosphere, what you are observing, has all the effects of the plasma propagation built in. And then next class we'll wrap up with some of this, a few more things about observables, and then I'll start on basic magnetospheric theory. Okay, so I would like to cover the basic concepts of Borel-Julien, and then. In the two lectures next week, if I don't run out of time, then I would like to go on to Deutsch magnetosphere. So, Borel-Julien, a little bit of Rudermann-Sutherland, and then Deutsch magnetosphere. So, this will be the agenda for next week.